Good morning and welcome to the 31st meeting of 2023 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. We apologise from our convener, Claire Baker, who's unable to be here today due to illness. So agenda item one is a decision on taking business in private. So our first item is the decision to take item three, which is consideration of evidence heard in private. Are members content to take that in private?
Agreed.
Agreed. Thank you. Agenda item two, our next item of business is an evidence session on Glasgow Prestwick Airport. This morning is an opportunity to discuss the operation and management of the airport, the Scottish Government's ownership, and progress towards the stated aim of returning it to private ownership. In September, the Cabinet Secretary wrote to the committee with an update on an expression of interest to purchase Scottish Minister's interest in the airport. We'll hear evidence over two panels this morning, and firstly, I'd like to welcome Ian Forgey, Chief Executive Officer, and Forsyth Black, Non-Executive Chairman, Glasgow Prestwick Airport. Afterwards, the committee will then take evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for Wellbeing, Economy, Fair Work and Energy. So I understand that Forsyth Black is going to make a short opening statement. I would invite you to do so now.
Okay, thank you, Convener. My name is Forsyth Black, Non-Executive Chair here at Glasgow Prestwick Airport, and with me is Ian Forgey, Chief Executive Officer. We're pleased to be able to join you remotely from the airport today, short notice, meaning our board commitments today made it unable to attend in person, but it is a pleasure to be able to attend online. When the Scottish Government took Glasgow Prestwick Airport over in 2013, it was undoubtedly a low point in the airport's history. And for the next 5 years, the airport struggled to perform and adapt to change. And as I'm sure the two Ayrshire MSPs and the committee will agree, in the last 5 years, the business has been turned around despite 2 years of a pandemic and is now stable and sustainably profitable, supporting over 1,000 jobs directly and many more indirectly as a catalyst for investment in Ayrshire. When people generally think of an airport, they tend to think of passengers only. This airport handles a modest number of passengers flying inbound and outbound on holiday and on business, but we're far more diverse and distinct than that. Every airport has a massive sunk cost in critical infrastructure, as do we. And the key turnaround effected by Ian and the team over the last few years has been to recognise that an airport with the profile of Prestwick does not survive on one business line alone. Alongside passenger operations, having a focus on developing cargo, charters, private military traffic and fueling while supporting aircraft maintenance and search and rescue operations right across Scotland and the UK and the like has been a key to its success. Being diversified also brings with it a level of business resilience. As anticipated cargo volumes dropped back in years of 2022-23 from a peak in 21-22, which had benefited from a spike in COVID-related freight, the last 12 months have been challenging, with global belly capacity returning and the ban on Russian registered freighters impacting the movement of heavy cargo. The board here is focused on growing our cargo business over the next few years and will continue to invest in equipment and to expand our facilities to meet demand, building on Prestwick's reputation for a fast, efficient and well-connected 24/7 cargo service. Post-COVID, the airport has managed to adapt and recruit, avoiding passenger queues and delays, with our staff working hard to deliver a safe, secure and efficient service. Passenger numbers are substantially up over the previous year. We're pleased to confirm a new 5-year agreement with our key passenger airline, Ryanair, and we look forward to working with them to grow passenger numbers further in the future. The airport remains an important base for Ryanair, with the maintenance, repair and overhaul facility on site employing approximately 600 people. We continue to provide excellent service to our military customers, with many nations operating aircraft through the airport, most notably the UK RAF, the USAF and the Royal Canadian Air Force. The airport has a reputation for hosting and supporting key training events, and in recent months we had a significant NATO training exercise here flown over Germany, and it was delivered with credit to our staff who delivered an excellent operational service. Achieving a horizontal spaceport facility has been an ambition of the airport for a number of years. It's a complex and specialised operation with high barriers to entry, and we continue to work closely with South Ayrshire Council, Scottish Enterprise and our potential launch partner to make this a reality. We continue to invest and upgrade our buildings and equipment and are developing a fresh master plan to maximise the utilisation of our 880-acre site. Taking practical action to achieve net zero targets is a key objective for the board, and we're pleased with the progress being made since our reference point in 2018. We believe we're well on our way to achieving our target of 50% carbon reduction by 2030. Recently, we've undertaken more Fabric First projects and made good progress with plans to invest in roof and ground-mounted solar energy, with the aim to become self-sufficient in electricity over the next 3 years. We're also working on supporting the market shift to sustainable aviation fuel to establish the airport as a key supply point for Scotland. Overall, the airport returned an operating profit of £2.1 million in its latest set of accounts, with, we believe, more to come in the future. Despite the ongoing economic pressures, the board is confident the airport will be able to build on this excellent recent performance. Scottish ministers' stated objectives remain to return Glasgow Prestwick Airport to private ownership when the time and circumstances are right to do so, and when a sale will provide the best possible return on their investment in the strategic asset. Until a credible and experienced investor comes forward, the board will continue to focus on growing the business and increasing its value. We'd like to thank our customers and our dedicated, loyal employees for their passion and commitment to Prestwick Airport and look forward to the continued success in the future. In closing, you will appreciate that this is a public forum and it's a commercial entity. There are some things we really can't discuss openly, but we'd be delighted to invite members of the committee with an interest in Glasgow Prestwick Airport to come and see firsthand what a fantastic asset it is for Scotland. That concludes our opening statements, so we can now take questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. As you say, I think there's quite a few questions for you. Let me start off with just a sort of a general question. What is the current strategy for the airport and how do you assess performance against that so far?
So the current strategy for the airport is more diverse, as I said in my opening statement, than one might think. This is not naturally a passenger airport. We have a smaller passenger catchment area than some of the bigger airports nearby. What we are is a diverse airport of passenger, cargo, military, private flights, fueling. We've got search and rescue facilities and a military base on our site. And the strategy is to take each of those business lines and maximise them to the best we possibly can, because having a number of different business lines producing contribution at an operating level adds to the total, which offsets the sunk cost of the infrastructure in the centre.
As you say, you're looking at very diverse businesses there. Each one in its own way is a speciality. Can Prestwick Airport be a specialist in so many diverse areas?
Well, I think that's the life of what I would describe as a tertiary airport. If we were London Heathrow Airport, we'd be all about passengers and very little about cargo and even less about anything else. But that's what we've got to be. We've got to be a master of as many things as we can. That doesn't mean that everything is given equal priority. At the moment, our strategy is very much that cargo is the priority. Passenger is very much a secondary thing. We wouldn't want to live without it, but it's a secondary thing. And looking after what we call FBO, fixed base operations flights, which include private jets, charters, and military flights, is up there as well, very near cargo. So the point is, we've got to concentrate on a number of things, not all of them equally, and we've got to dial that up and down as the market changes round about us.
Thank you. Maybe I can call Kevin Stewart.
Thank you very much, convener. In terms of those military operations and planning, how reliant have the revenues been linked to those military operations and planning? And how can you effectively plan with this revenue stream being uncertain?
Yeah, well, good morning, everyone. Good morning, convener. Thank you for hearing this morning. And just before I ask the question, just reflecting back 5 years ago when I first appeared before the REC committee, as it was, the airport has changed significantly from there. What a fantastic asset it is. And when we first did 5 years ago, the main focus was on passengers. That was the main revenue stream. But as soon as we got in and got in to turn around the business and maybe make it grow and diversify, we identified that many strengths and the ability to handle international air forces has been one of its strengths for many years. We'll be over 100 years old next year, and the airport has always had a strong connection with the military. So it's not something that comes and goes. It's something that's been built up over recent years. And I think we handle over 20 air forces, international air forces. And why did they come to Scotland? Why did they come to Prestwick? Well, it's 24/7. It's got two long runways, lots of parking and apron space, and an excellent service. So it's a great part of our business, and it's something we continue to work on.
I think in terms of how we plan for that sort of thing, what we do is we look at individual events that we know are going to come up, like the recent NATO exercises, and we plan for those because they're a known thing. We look at the world round about us, so things like, you know, the conflict in Ukraine has driven military traffic, and we know from experience that is something we need to then set aside resource for. But also there's a long-term historical trend. As Ian says, international militaries have been coming through Prestwick since the Second World War or even before that. And we've got a long, long history of how that's progressed over the years. So there is an averaging effect that you can take into account when you're planning. And to be quite frank, over the years, that just become better and better and better with experience in terms of the accuracy of that planning.
Okay, I don't think you've got to the nub of the question in terms of your answers there. What are the alternatives for these air forces other than Prestwick? So why Prestwick?
Well, that's exactly what Ian was just referring to there. In terms of the long runway, we've got the longest runway north of Manchester. A lot of these long-haul military, heavy military cargo aircraft, particularly from the American military and the Canadian military, they can technically land at other airports in Scotland, but can they take off fully fueled and fully laden? I would suggest not. So in terms of this part of the world, where we're in a great circle between for transatlantic flights, we aren't the only game in town, but we're the most appropriate game in town.
Okay. There have been some controversies over the years around about some of the flights coming into and leaving Prestwick, not just Prestwick, also Aberdeen in my own patch, flights that it has been suggested to have been used for extraordinary rendition. How does Prestwick Airport ensure that there is no breaking of international law and that the airport is not profiting from such?
All military aircraft that come into the UK have to be authorised by the UK government. So it's only, for example, Russian aircraft are banned currently. But it's a government-led authorisation for aircraft to land in any airport in the UK. We don't get involved in rendition flights. That's just not what we do.
So you have said, you are categoric that there have been no extraordinary rendition flights entering into Prestwick, unless, of course, they have been cleared by the UK government. Is that what you're saying?
Well, I think what we're saying is every flight is cleared by the UK government, and we cannot be categoric on what happens on those flights because it's confidential often to the operator. The doors on some aircraft are not opened when they come through here. What goes on board is not something we're sometimes party to, but what we are party to is the legality of those flights.
So extraordinary rendition is illegal under international law.
Therefore, I presume the UK government would not allow it to happen, and therefore we would not handle it, and therefore, by extension, we'd never handle it.
Okay, that's grand. So that would be the UK government's responsibility then. Let's turn to your ambitions for a spaceport. The annual accounts note that achieving a horizontal spaceport has been an ambition for a number of years. What are the benefits of securing this for the airport? What progress have you made over the past number of years? What are the main barriers that you need to overcome? And what analysis have you done of the competition, a lot of competition even here in Scotland, around about leading in terms of spaceport flights?
Yes, spaceport and as we said in our accounts, have been a long-held objective. It's a complex and specialised market, and as we've seen in the UK with the failure of Newquay, can have disastrous results. So it's not something anyone enters into lightly, and it's very important that you get the right technical partner who's going to operate it. And to be clear, it is the partner who's going to be operating the flights. We are the airport that's hosting the facilities and responsible for the safety and security of the aircraft and its contents leaving Scotland and out of the airspace. That's our responsibility. The technical handling and marketing and generation of payload for satellites is responsibility of the operator or the partner we're having that we're doing discussions with. So it is complex. The barriers to entry are high, and we're working closely with this partner and with the space industry and the regulator to make this a reality. But it's not a short game. It's a long game in this. We're quite encouraged recently in terms of the investor funding that the partner has raised in recent months, and we're working closely with the council and Scottish Enterprise to make that a reality.
You haven't really talked about what the barriers are. What are the barriers and how can they be overcome?
Well, the barriers are the technical barriers. You need to have a solution that's safe, a solution that, I mean, this has got rocket fuel in it. It's got a capacity to take off. It needs to point and shoot and release its content safely into the airspace. So the biggest barrier is licensing. That's a highly complex area which the CAA required to issue licences for. So that's the main technical complication. In terms of building a spaceport here, it's a physical building. Our part of that is making sure that's safe and secure with fuel storage facilities and making sure that the safety issues. So there's a lot of technical stuff that goes on in the background.
In my previous role, I've met with the Civil Aviation Authority around about some of these issues. Can you tell us a little bit about your discussions with the Civil Aviation Authority around about the licensing aspect and ensuring that you know, the safety aspect is there if and when you become a spaceport?
Well, we've engaged with our licensing application. We just recently put our application in. And our technical team are building our safety case, which we then present to the CAA. It's not the CAA don't come and tell you what to do. We have to present our safety case, and then they approve that and grant the licence.
OK, thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Can I bring in Brian Whittle, followed by Evelyn Tweed?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, gentlemen, and I declare a lifelong interest in Prestwick Airport from the start, given I used to live in Moncton, and I'm old enough to have joined the crowds in the football field across from my house to watch the inaugural flight of Concorde in 1969. And that's how old I am, I'm afraid. Gentlemen, I wanted to use my time really to look at the airport's income streams beyond flight operations, in particular agreements with wind farm developers for mitigation payments. You'll be aware of a report from Clochrane and Sanker findings. And it seems, to having read that report, that the airport's approach to negotiating mitigation settlements with wind farms has been challenged in a number of recent planning inquiries for these developments. And from comments made by wind farm developers and reporters, I think it's reasonable to say that your approach is more aggressive than is the norm. And in particular, you've sought to receive ongoing payments beyond an initial lump sum. You've sought to receive payments based on the number of megawatts generated, and perhaps, I think, most worryingly, you've taken an approach that used non-disclosure agreements to conceal the value of payments and prevent public scrutiny. Is that, and I'm taking that straight from the report, do you feel that's an accurate description of the approach you've taken with wind farms?
Okay. Listen, as there's an ongoing public inquiry, I can't comment in specifics regarding wind farms. However, Wind farms have a significant impact on airports, in particular Prestwick. And I would encourage you, Brian, when you do come down to visit the airport, we will show you some detail of that. We have the highest concentration of developments planned in the UK, if not Europe, with over 700 turbines visible to the airport. And there's an entire wall of them at the top end of our runway, main runway. So it's a complex and technical area, which we must be satisfied, absolutely satisfied, that doesn't impact on the airport safety. That's paramount. And developers need to contribute to that, but that's the bottom line. They need to pay for this in order for them to be mitigated. They need to pay for that, and that's the fundamental. And I have also to say that to date, the airport has supported over 1 gigawatts of wind farm applications. We have really been pushing hard to make these things happen, and that's part of that whole agenda from pushing out wind farms. So it's a complex subject, but I do encourage you to come down and we'll take you through some of the detail, because until you understand the technical detail and the problem that is for the aviation, is not just Prestwick, although Prestwick has the biggest concentration because of its location, and it's a significant issue for the airport which we need to defend.
Just so you know, I spoke to NATS last week specifically, so as I understood. I've also spoken to wind farm developers. Now, I'm talking about Clochrane and Sankar. I know there's other ongoing public inquiries into this, but I'm talking specifically in Clochrane and Sankar, and these things are in the public domain. If I can quote from the Clochrane report, the minister's response to this agreed with the reporter's conclusion that there's no basis for ongoing compensatory payments to be made. And my concern here is that you are using wind farm money specifically. I'm sorry, don't shake your head, Mr. Foggett. That's what it says in the report. It says it in the report that you're using wind farms as an income stream. And it also says in here that you have to demonstrably show how you're using that money specifically to mitigate any issues with wind farms. And that's what the report says. So would you not agree that if that's the case, and if these things are sitting within your ledger, they will have to come out, so that will impact the profitability of the airport?
Disagree with all that.
Sorry, Mr. Foggett, it says it in the public inquiry report. You can't disagree with the reporter and the minister.
There's an ongoing public inquiry, and I cannot comment particularly any particular inquiries that are connected to that. However, there's a significant impact on this airport, and it will cost it significant money for the next 25, 30 years to ensure that there's the safety caused the impact caused by these wind farms.
I think it's worth just stepping back a second to just explain that you've also got specific knowledge in this matter, maybe some other members of the committee do not. The issue here is that Prestwick, as Ian says, has a significant number of wind turbines within its radar picture. When aircraft cross those wind turbines, there is a risk that the radar goes blind, and we need to upgrade our radar to be at basically the top of the very top of the range at some vast expense to be able to mitigate that and ensure that the approach into our airport is safe. Though that situation is solely caused by the building of wind farms in our radar picture, and we have to mitigate against that. That's why they're called mitigation agreements. And the wind farm operators know this. They build these mitigation costs into their business models because they know that in due course they're going to have to make a contribution to the airport, us or another airport, to mitigate the effect of those wind farms. They build those amounts into their business models, and then it appears in some cases they try then to make the case not to pay them. And ultimately, if they don't pay, because the Scottish Government owns Glasgow Prestwick Airport, ultimately it's up to us and therefore by extension the Scottish taxpayer to pay for amounts that are already budgeted by the wind farm operators. It doesn't really make sense, does it?
No, I'm afraid the evidence that I've taken from NATS disagrees with that. You have a Terma radar system that is currently in the process, I understand, of potentially being deployed. Having spoken to the wind farms themselves, they are absolutely agreed that they do have to pay some mitigation, but that has to be demonstrated by the airport, which they say hasn't been done. And secondly, they also, as I said, the report says that there are no basis for ongoing compensatory payments to be made. That is a quote directly from the Cabinet Secretary. And if I'll also say that the reporter says that it's clear that a per megawatt basis for the calculation of any contribution would not be appropriate. Now, I understand there are more ongoing findings coming down the road, but this is from Clockery and Sanker. And I think what's important here is that there's an agreement that they should mitigate. There should be a capex payment for any upgrade or replacement of a radar system. There's an agreement with that. But what the report is saying is you haven't quantified that, and what you're trying to do is get ongoing payments out of wind farms to pay for a radar system that's still not in operation, and the wind farms are up and the airport is still functioning. So again, I'm saying to you that this is being used as an income stream, and that's what the report says.
Well, there's definitely an income stream out of it, but there's a very large cost line that goes with that.
And you can demonstrate, everything that's coming out from the wind farm payments is being ring-fenced specifically to pay for an upgrade of radar.
This is a complex subject, and as I said, I encourage you to come down and we'll certainly take you through.
I have tried twice, Mr. Forgate. I'm asking a really simple question here. Is the money coming out of the wind farm that's been to mitigate any issue with radar being ring fenced specifically to upgrade your radar? That's all I'm asking you.
Well, one of the problems, and this is why you do need to understand more detail, and you do have to understand that this is a complex subject, it's an evolving subject, and we have significant 700 visible turbines that are planned to be built. This is not a one wind farm issue that is just simply put in a box. This is evolving and has evolved over the last 5 years, and has got to the stage now. This is significant. So we need to look for the next 25, 30 years and what that's going to, the impact of the airport is going to be. And I do encourage you to spend more time listening to the airport to understand that position, which obviously you're a vested interest in protecting and making sure for local Ayrshire grows and survives. And this is a really, really important matter. So I encourage you to spend some more time with
them. I'm happy to, but I will again say to you, I specifically spent some time with NATS last week to understand exactly from their perspective what is required from a radar system. And it's not just press reports, it's a network of radar systems across Scotland.
Yes, but Crestwick's the biggest one that's impacted.
I'm going to ask you a simple question again. Is the money, the revenues that are coming out of the wind farms being ring-fenced specifically for mitigation and not for any other measures? That's what I'm asking you.
Which so far has been spent on radars, but the radar technology that's now going to be required is significant going forward. That's a moving feast. As this has grown bigger and bigger, we need to build more, we have to get more radars, not just one solution. So it is far more complex than that going forward.
If I may, just one more thing. I just want, one of the things that I'd heard was that there was a runway report in 2019. Presumably, you're aware of that.
What's the runway? What's been?
Well, there's issues with in terms of when you're when somebody applies to buy the airport or to purchase the airport, you would do a report. And that would include a runway report in 2019, is that correct?
There was no runway report issued as part of that sale process.
So you wouldn't put a runway report into a purchase? Anything?
No, it would be diligence required by the buyer. The person who was buying it may ask for that, but it didn't happen in that case.
Okay.
I think Colin Smith wants to come in the back of that question.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, gentlemen. Can I just follow up on the issue of the wind farm developments? Now, I appreciate you disagree with the comments of the reporter in the case of the wind farm near Sanker, but presumably that does have an impact on your future business. You must be building in when it comes to future assumptions of income streams from developments that wind farm companies will follow what the reporter said in his comments, and those future agreements will be less than the ones that you've secured at the moment. Has that been built into your future planning, and what impact is that likely to have on your income?
Well, again, I have to say this is linked to this current public inquiry that's about a couple of the public inquiries coming up. There's one coming up quite shortly in the new year. And there's significant new evidence coming into that, connected to that. So it's an ongoing position as far as we're concerned. So, yes, and clearly, if you took that black and white, that would have a significant impact on us. And we're concerned, but we believe we've got the evidence to show. And that's why I'm referring back to the next public inquiry. Evidence to show that this is a big problem and it needs to be funded.
But I think it's fair to say that the decision of the public inquiry just gone by does not affect doesn't have a knock-on effect to the public inquiries in the future. It was a specific outcome based on that public inquiry in isolation. It doesn't mean that mitigation payments will stop in future. It means they may be restructured or changed in some way, and therefore we do think we can cut our cloth to match that.
Let me bring in Evelyn Tweed, followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, gentlemen. Your most recent annual accounts note that fuel amounts to the vast majority of the airport's revenues. What do you think the outlook is for this segment?
Well, aircraft that come in need to be fueled. It's the inevitability of running an airport. But there is an airline industry wide move towards things like sustainable aviation fuel. And we've recently reorganised our deal with our fuel supplier here, who also manages and runs and takes some responsibility for upkeep of our fuel farm, where we've got, I think, seven tanks. And recently refurbished them with the purpose of getting ourselves to a capacity that we can actually start to dedicate in the near term future, dedicate at least one tank to sustainable aviation fuel. We have a railway siding here that allows us to take fuel in from the refineries by rail, which is kind of unique in Scotland and maybe even unique in Britain. And as a result, we're able to take deliveries in bulk quite quickly. So there is a plan afoot to start to dedicate at least one of those tanks in the beginning to sustainable aviation fuel, so that we can become a key point for distribution of sustainable aviation fuel for Scotland until the market gets to a critical mass, where each airport individually will have the bulk of its fuel stored as sustainable aviation fuel.
Okay, thanks for that. You've spoken a lot about diversification, but in terms of passengers and cargo, they obviously make up quite a bit less in terms of your revenue. You said earlier on about the five-year new agreement with Ryanair. I mean, how do you see passengers? Is that going to be something that's getting bigger? You had said earlier on that's what the airport used to focus on. And obviously, Scotland is interested in expanding its tourism offering. Is that going to expand? And where do you see cargo going?
So passenger will expand. I mean, if you think back to the history of Prestwick Airport, it was a big passenger airport, partly because aviation technology didn't allow long-haul aircraft from America to go all the way to Heathrow in one jump. Those days have gone. Now you can fly across the world, halfway across the world in one jump without stopping. So therefore, Prestwick lost that market. But a lot of the passengers in those days were not really terminating or originating passengers. They were through passengers. So what we've got now is a much more pure passenger model, where the people coming in and out of Prestwick are originating and departing Prestwick. So they're outbound, they're tourism to the others, to somewhere in Europe usually, or business people, and inbound they're business people, and they're inbound tourism for the golfing in South Ayrshire, the countryside in South Ayrshire, that sort of thing. So we do end up with a smaller base of passenger. And it will expand. We've just recently had three Ryanair routes launched through the summer after a new deal. One of them hasn't done as well as it could have done, has been cut for now. We're expecting a little bit of winter activity from Ryanair that we didn't have last year, and we're expecting them to do even more routes next year as part of our new deal. So we do see it expanding. We talk from time to time to other passenger-based aircraft airlines. They're not our vast focus because we know that we've got to focus more heavily on things like cargo and military at the moment, but because we've got a limited catchment area and the vast amount of the west of Scotland's passengers go through Glasgow International. It doesn't mean there isn't a market for Prestwick. It doesn't mean that at all. It just means that we have to play on the margins and we catch the business that sort of falls between the cracks in some ways.
OK, that's good. Good to know. Good to know that it's expanding. Prestwick Aerospace currently provides a range of modern apprenticeships in collaboration with Ayrshire College and South Ayrshire Council. Where do you see this offering going? Is this going to expand?
Indeed. One of our, aeronautical engineering is a strength for the Prestwick Airport. We've got Prestwick Aircraft Maintenance, which is Ryanair and Chevron, teamed them, I think, over 600, 700 jobs, and they want to expand. And it's an issue that we've identified in the last 12 months, a significant shortage of aeronautical engineers not being able to meet the demand locally. So we've been working closely with the college and the council to try and address that, to try and encourage skills and get more apprenticeships back into the shop floor, really, really important. So we're quite passionate about trying to play our part of that in the airport. What I'd like to see is a live aircraft training facility on site, and we're working with them closely with a project with that. And they're very keen to see that because it's a whole system, getting through the schools, getting schools into training, quickly back into jobs and getting the tickets to be able to supply a job. And there's high-value jobs that are being attracted to Prestwick.
We've had some interest over the last couple of years in increasing the MRO and maintenance, repair and overhaul offering here at Prestwick. There have been some parties interested if we could build hangars for them to do maintenance in. They've not always been the highest quality requests for business, but the point is hangars cost a lot of money. You know, to build a hangar for a 2 wide-bodied aircraft to be tail-in is, you know, 50, 60, 70 million pounds. And for those projects to be pushed forward, we'd have to have pretty heavy guarantees from the customers in the end so that we weren't building infrastructure for no income. So we've got to be quite careful about these things. And the board is very aware of the risks that are involved in some of these high-value projects. But there is latent demand out there. Now, as Ian says, we've got to solve first thing first. You know, it's all very well, you know, throwing a hangar up at great expense. We've got to have guarantees for it, but we've also got to have the people to operate that. And that means aircraft engineers. There is a shortage in Britain. There's probably a shortage in the world right now if we look right across the world. But as we say, we're working with Ayrshire College to start to bring through people on aircraft engineering qualifications so that they can join the workplace in the Ayrshire area in the future.
Thank you. Gordon MacDonald, followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, panel. Couple of questions about your accounts. Had a quick look at the TS Prestwick Hold Company, and you quite rightly pointed out that you've made a profit in recent years of about £2 million for the last 2 years. But looking at the subsidiaries, it says that Glasgow Prestwick Airport, who carry out the airport operations, actually made a loss of £1.5 million. And Prestwick Airport Limited, which is a property management company, made the profit of £2.4 million. Now, I realise these figures are before your revaluation reserve and before the financial costs, but could you say a wee bit more about the importance of Prestwick Airport Limited?
One of the other strengths is the size of this estate. It's over 800 acres of land and buildings. We've got 70 tenants, both airside and landside, aeronautical and non-aeronautical. And actually, we see that's one of our strengths to grow. There's a real shortage of commercial space, industrial units, and we've got high demand down at Prestwick, which is great. So there is opportunities for us to grow. In terms of the financials, you do need to look at it as a group position to STS Holdco. Some of that's historic in terms of those historic companies. So we've got management charges going from one to the other. So really just looking at the historic report, which is why we use the breakdown in the group accounts to really see what the performance of the business is. But it's multifaceted. We've got a big infrastructure cost in the airport, and some of the historical stuff is the land zoned in another part of the business, and there's charges going across it intercompany. So take it over as over around. The business has been profitable for the last 4 years, cash generative, and it's a significantly different picture than I took over 5 years ago, which is loss making. So it's a great journey to be on. And we want to build on that and continue to build on all the strengths of all the different parts of the airport, whether it be property, passengers, cargo, our general aviation business. And we've got some new ventures coming in, including Spaceport is one of them, but drone activity. There's other things that are coming into the business which are really quite exciting.
You know, I accept what you're saying, that it's a package and that the property arm of the holding company is basically supporting the airport operations. You talked about your master plan earlier on for the 900 acres that you guys have got. Could you say a wee bit more about that and the importance of that to the viability of Prestwick?
So planning for an airport is not a thing for next year or the year after. It's a thing for 10 years, 20 years, 30 years out. It's massive undertakings. So typically how that starts is with a master plan, which is tends to be a conceptual plan around how will the airport be laid out on a macro level over those very long-term timescales. So it might take, and in fact, in Prestwick's case, it does take the form of, is the terminal still going to be the same shape it is? Is it going to be the same place it is? Is the cargo area going to be where it is? Or do we need that land for something else? And over the 10, 20, 30 years, is it perhaps going to move somewhere? And we're not in any way suggesting we're going to realign the runways or anything like that. But master planning in theory could cover all that sort of thing. But we have to look at how it's almost like taking the 30,000 foot view and looking down on the airport in terms of the way it's physically laid out and how you would move the chess pieces on the chessboard below you. And then you start to drill that down into more tactical planning around, right, if we're going to if we get to target X for our cargo business, do we then need to start creating land free around about the cargo area, or do we need to move the cargo area somewhere else to be able to enable its expansion later on in line with our planning? Similarly, for example, we look far enough down the road that there's a potential, a very distant potential for more rail freight coming in and out of Prestwick, so it can go on to aircraft thereafter. We've got access to railways here. They run right past the site, but we don't necessarily have a siding that's suitable for cargo trains to come in and park and be loaded and offloaded with enough room round about them to do that operation. But there is a route, potentially, planning permission allowing and so on and so on, that another siding could be built into the airport. If that was built where it is, the master plan says the cargo area would have to move. That's not going to happen in the next 10 years. That's something much further down the road. So it is about taking that 30,000 foot view and thinking about how you're going to move your strategic assets around the board below you, and then how that translates down into shorter term projects and ultimately all the way down to an operating budget for next year.
So that sounds like an awful lot of investment that's required over the next 30 years. And given that
it depends. It depends. It depends on what aspects of the master plan are goers and what are not. You know, a master plan to some extent can be a dream, a dream of what you could do if you had unlimited resource. But no business, publicly or privately owned, has unlimited resource, and every single investment has to make a return. It has to make a return in the public or the private sector. And we, as a board, ensure that when we do invest money here, it makes a proper return, because we're setting this business up on a commercial footing to be sold back into the commercial world. And if we don't make sure that our capital is allocated correctly and has the correct returns, it'll become an unsaleable asset, and we have no intention of allowing that.
Is it in the best interest, I mean, if you've got this master plan for 30 years to reinvent Prestwick, if you like, we've seen in previous decades that the airport was owned by the Canadian entrepreneur Matthew Hudson, then the Stagecoach Group, then Infratil, and then obviously Scottish Government took it over in 2013. Is it in the best interest either getting access to finance or operationally for it to remain within the owner, public ownership, or should it be moved over to the commercial side?
Well, it's a stated aim of our owners, the Scottish Government, to return it to the commercial sector.
I'm asking if you've got a view on that.
Yeah, I'm coming to that.
Okay.
So that's a stated aim, and that's the framework under which we work. Now, that works because we've taken the former Infratil asset, which was loss-making, we've turned it around to become profitable. It's sustainably profitable. The more profit it makes, the higher the value it will have when it is ultimately returned to the private sector. So it is absolutely a going concern to return it to the private sector. The question for us is, how can we maximise value for the Scottish taxpayer when at the point that liquidity event happens?
Okay. So a couple of final questions. One, you know, you've said you've returned to profitability over the last 4 years, you've returned a profit. At what point do you intend to start paying dividends? And secondly, you have a loan debt of £43 million, and I noticed that the interest is accruing in the background. It was £7 million previous year, it's now £9 million. When will some of that start to be repaid to the Scottish Government?
So that loan and rolled up interest would be payable on a liquidity event. So a liquidity event could be a sale, a restructure, a merger, whatever it is. It's got to be something that releases cash to pay back. This is an airport is a costly thing to run. So until that happens.
I was thinking more about the interest and the dividend.
Well, so interest-wise, what we have is a deal which is done with the Scottish Government on commercial terms, commercial interest rates, and a commercial arrangement of what's known as payment in kind, which is a roll-up of interest. So the interest rolls up and is only paid back at the end like a balloon payment. And that is a common structure that's used in projects like this. It's used in the private sector in private equity deals and so on. It's quite similar to what might happen at somewhere like Glasgow or Edinburgh Airport, where they've got private equity owners. It's no different, and the point there is to protect the company's day-to-day cash so that they can recover and rebuild their business with a view to paying the dividends and the money back later on when there's that liquidity point when the cash is released to do so.
Okay, yeah. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Maggie Chapman, followed by Colin Smith.
Thanks very much, Colin, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us this morning. I've got a couple of questions. The first first cluster of questions are around environmental impact and net zero. And, Forsyth, you mentioned in your opening comments the activities in progress made in relation to net zero and reducing emissions within the airport's operations. Can I just ask, if we think of environmental impact beyond carbon emissions, how do you measure and assess your environmental impact on the immediate environment where you are? And I'm not talking about carbon emissions, I'm talking about other impacts.
I think we have focus on carbon, to be fair. That's our first and foremost. It's the easiest thing we can look at. And we're quite proud of the fact that we've actually got a plan that's practical looking at it. I think if we divide the airport infrastructure and looking at Fabric First and all the good things we've been doing, which is what we think we can control, and reducing that by 50% by 2030 is a really good aim for us. And I think if we can become sustainable in terms of energy, which is to do with our electricity network and becoming that sustainable solar energy, etc., that's another part of our objective as well. I think we split into aviation fuel, which is another big impact environment, and aircraft, etc.
Ian, if I can stop you there, I asked specifically about non-carbon, non-emissions environmental impact.
Okay.
Are you talking about things like pollutants and things like that?
Well, I'm asking you what your assessment of your non-carbon environmental impact is, how you measure, how you monitor, and how you mitigate. You know, you've got, as you've told us, over 800. You know, you've got a substantial site to manage. How are you measuring that your broader environmental impact where you are?
Yes. Well, I think, you know, things like sewage and water and if that the kind of things you're talking about.
And other pollutants.
Yes. Well, I mean, the biggest for us is obviously controlling fuel in the air, for et cetera, and measuring, making sure we're protecting that, because that's the biggest pollutant that we handle. But in terms of things like water management, et cetera, we've got an environmental officer who deals with that and monitors that, monitors the waste products, monitors the quality of water, inputs and outputs.
In terms of things like fuel getting into public waterways and things like that, aviation fuel farms are regulated by very, very tight regulations. We ensure those are adhered to properly. We've got proper emergency plans should there be a leak. We've got proper plans in terms of things like monitoring public waterways. And we know what we'll do if indeed there was a leak. The only other thing I can think of off the top of my head might be, given the weather outside, is de-icing fluid. But de-icing takes place in certain areas of the airport only, where the de-icing fluid goes into specific drains, which are designed to take those fluids and isolate them from getting into public waterways. So beyond that, and carbon emissions, direct carbon emissions from fuel, I can't think of anything else you might be referring to.
What about light pollution and noise pollution?
Well, noise pollution obviously comes from aircraft. Aircraft are becoming less noisy as time goes on, as engine technology gets better and better. That I suppose looks after itself in as much as aircraft.
But so you're not routinely monitoring either of those?
I'm not saying we're not monitoring it. What I'm saying is when an aircraft arrives, it arrives. It makes the noise it makes. We can't stop that except by stopping them arriving, and that will be cutting our own throat.
But you still have a responsibility to monitor and assess what those impacts are, and I'm not hearing that you're doing that, because I think particularly with noise, you know, that they're things you can do with different flight paths and flight path management and that kind of thing, which I haven't heard you talk about. But I'll move on to the sustainable aviation fuel. And earlier this year, the Royal Society published a report that indicated that they looked at a suite of options, you know, for the four different options that are looking like there might be some possibility in sustainable aviation fuel development, and concluded that none of the four actually look like they're going to replace fossil jet fuel in the near future. So I just wonder if you can outline how quantified is your assessment of or your target of being able to replace one of your seven fuel tanks with SAF, and what kind of timescale are you looking at? How robust is that, or is it just wishful? You know, is it you want to be able to do it, but actually the technology isn't there yet?
Well, the tanks are there, and our supplier is very keen to be partnering in that and to establish that. So they're at the forefront. It's BP, who's our supplier, fuel supplier here. So they've invested in sustainable aviation fuel, and they want to improve that supply chain to get it on field, to get it onto airports, to get it being used, to encourage airlines, which again is a complex subject, how you get airlines to convert into SAF, because there's a cost to it, and it's a bit whether it's mandated by governments. And I think that's probably what's going to have to happen, as it happens in other countries, for that to change that. But what we can do, what all we can really do is encourage that by having a supply of SAF and encouraging our airlines and users to use it.
But I suppose I haven't heard an answer to the how confident are you in the ability of this to happen, given that the Royal Society is quite clear that, you know, in the short term, none of the options that are currently being explored and research being done on them, none of them look likely to replace fossil jet fuel in the short term. And so I suppose I'm looking at longer-term risk here. If you're saying that, yes, we will do this, I haven't heard a time scale. And what happens if and when that doesn't happen in terms of your overall assessment?
So last week, Virgin Atlantic flew a flight from London Heathrow to JFK and 100% sustainable aviation fuel. That was the first one that went transatlantic with passengers on board. And that was successful. There is a slow move towards sustainable aviation fuel in the industry. We're in a position that we can help enable that because we've got 7 tanks. We don't necessarily need all 7 all the time. And we can, with BP's help, we can put one aside in the near future. I'm not going to say in 3 years' time or 2 years' time or 1 year's time, but it could be as soon as 1 year's time. But I'm not going to guarantee it, that one of those tanks becomes purely sustainable aviation fuel because we've got the capacity in Scotland to do that. Now, I'm not sure that some of the other airports in Scotland have a spare tank that they can put aside for sustainable aviation fuel. So what we can do and what part of the plan is, put one of ours aside where we have capacity and then use it as the sustainable aviation fuel market grows, we can use it to supply other airports where they only need small amounts until such times as they've got the critical mass to transfer their entire infrastructure over to sustainable aviation fuel.
Yeah. So I think it's about enabling it. To be clear, the tank itself has been used for SAF already. We use it through June COP 26, so we supplied SAF on site for the visiting heads of states that came here. And so we had that set up. So it's not a technical issue from our perspective. I think the bigger barrier is getting them to use it, which is a bigger, more complex subject.
Okay, so, I mean, I understand the opportunities there, and you're ready. You seem like you're ready to take advantage of those if they materialise. My final question on a different topic. The Audit Scotland has recommended the development of a clear exit strategy for public investment in the airport, and I just wondered how you are assessing and measuring value for money of that public sector investment, that public money investment.
Well, I think the value for money calculation, whilst we're party to it, would only happen at Scottish Government level because we are not necessarily aware of what value they hold Prestwick Airport at in their own books. So in terms of the public purse, that's the level at which any calculation would have to happen. However, we know what it looks like from our books point of view, and we can sort of stage ourselves, well, look, if someone comes along and say, for example, stupidly offers a pound or something like that, we're going to say, oh, we made 2.1 million last year, and we can value the business based on that and take account of debt and so on, and a pound would be a silly number. So it's not going to be that, and we're going to chase those sort of offers away or as spurious. But it is something that at Scottish Government level has to be looked at, and I think it's maybe a question for them.
And let's not just forget also about the jobs that we sustain here. So when we talk about value, you know, the value to the Scottish economy in Ayrshire is significant. You know, it's well over 1,000 jobs now with some growth. Some of our local employees here want to grow and expand, so we see more jobs coming through here directly linked with the airport, but also many, many more jobs around that as well. So there's a significant impact to the airport, to the local economy as well. So it's a bigger statement in terms of value.
Okay, and do you, I couldn't find it in your report, in the annual report, and apologies if I've missed it, but assess or quantifying and monitoring social return on investment. I couldn't see that in the report. Could you just say a little bit more? Maybe it's an extension of what you were saying there in around jobs and wider community, but I just wondered if there was more you wanted to say on that.
I think it's worth just saying that, you know, as I became chairman, I inherited a company that had and a board that had been concentrated solely on turning this business around and making it profitable again. And maybe some of the reporting around that hadn't been developed as much because that was the concentration. Now, what you might have noticed recently is that we started to put together more of what you might call a glossy report around other things other than just the accounting numbers, and that's in its infancy at the moment. And I would expect that will develop over the coming years to include more wider reporting on things like social matters, governance matters, and environmental matters for that for that matter. We just have to maybe forgive us a little bit, but the team was very much focused on filling the black hole of losses for 5 years and turning the business around.
One thing I would say, though, just in terms of social side, that what really makes Prestwick stand out is its people. You know, one of the things I'm really impressed with is the Prestwick team spirit. We have a fantastic set of people here who work so well, because we do everything here, from air traffic control, passenger handling, ground handling, every set of classes, everything is here, and we're part of the Prestwick team. So there's a real impact, of what, and that's the biggest asset, quite frankly, for any business, and that's been really my focus, to empower those people and encourage them, and to start to pay better conditions and pay better. What we've done in the last 2 years, which is about giving back to the economy.
Okay, thanks. That's helpful. I'll leave it there.
Thank you. Time is getting a wee bit tight, so I'm going to ask both the members asking questions and the panel responding to be fairly succinct. Colin Smith, followed by Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning again to the panel. Mr Fogg, you mentioned earlier the previous REC committee sessions. I remember them well, and you've said that the airport's obviously changed a lot since then. It's a strong asset, and I very much agree with that. So why do you think so far there hasn't been a bid for the airport that, in the view of the Scottish Government, has been an acceptable bid for its sale?
Well, there was, almost before, pre-COVID, we were 95% through to a sale process, but unfortunately the pandemic hit and that bidder had to withdraw because there were another airport business, and that was a significant impact on them, so they had to focus on the investments elsewhere. So that's simply not true at that time. You know, we need to set the bar pretty high here, because we want to make sure we've got the right home for this. We've turned it into a profitable business. We now want to make it to, if it's going to be sold, it has to be in the right hands with real aviation experience to take it to the next generation, next level.
Bids for the airport or any business are very distracting to senior management, because they take up a lot of time. They sop up a lot of time. And the board has recognised that. And what we've done is made sure that there's a pre-filter put in place, so that any spurious bids or bids that are that don't have the correct financial backing, they don't have provable financial backing, they don't have the correct experience, they don't, you know, and various other things don't fit, don't go beyond the first filter. Otherwise, we will end up down a rabbit hole of Ian and his team doing nothing but managing potentially spurious bids, and not paying attention to their day job. And it's more important that they pay attention to their day job, deliver value for the taxpayer and the owner, and look at only those bids that can be pre-qualified as being, you know, credible and viable.
And the other thing, just to finalise, just to give a quick comment on this, is 5 years is a big difference from making losses in the history of that to now turn into profit. It's a far more attractive asset now. And the timing is, you may come on to that when the right time of that is, but my job and our job is to continue to build that focus. The bigger the profits, back to that measure again, the bigger the value, the bigger value for the shareholder.
So are there any credible bids on the table at the moment?
As we said, we've had bids. I'm currently looking at one expression of interest that is going through that early process of diligence. And we'll get more details in due course.
We'll put it through that filter, and we'll recommend upwards to the Scottish Government what the board thinks is the realistic next step.
But the criteria is quite high again. It has to go through a robust process.
So just for the record, can you tell us how many bids you've received in total that have then been passed to the Scottish Government with a recommendation for sale from the board?
Well, during my time as chair, none. We've received a small number of bids during my time as chair, and each one has been has not passed every test that's required.
So there's not been any bids since the sale of the airport in 2013 that have gone to the Scottish Government with a recommendation.
During my time as chair, which is the last 2 years approximately.
I refer to the one that was prior to the pandemic. And that was a recommendation, it was in its final preferred bidder status. So again, that was purely down to the impact of the pandemic.
So I suppose that's a final question. This, you obviously find yourself in quite a limbo position. We've talked earlier, it was mentioned the loans that have been paid, or rather having been paid back by the government, have effectively revalued them, or the auditors have revalued them at just £11 million because you're not making any payments towards the loans. You've talked about investment so far. Presumably you're not in a position to make the level of investment that's needed in the airport unless you either get money from the government or you have a new owner who will make that investment. There must be a lot of outstanding investment. Audit Scotland, for example, said recently that, you know, millions more will be needed to sustain the airport in its current model. You know, this limbo position can't go on. Either we take a decision that says you're publicly owned with the support of government, or we need a sale.
Yeah, our operational cash flow at the moment sustains our business. And what we're using the remaining loan amount for is only structural development projects with a proper payback for the long term that add value to a potential sale. So we're not using, if you like, if you want to put it in these terms, we're not using our sort of nest egg on day-to-day expenses. The day-to-day expenses are covered by the operational cash flow of the business. So the business is sustainable in its own right. What we're using the remaining part of the loan for at the moment is things like potentially looking at putting the solar farms up, which will have a payback for a normal level of payback for that investment, and therefore a lot of value to the airport.
But so it's not true that the airport needs millions of pounds to sustain it. Is it cash positive and sustainable as it is right now?
But it does.
I think it's fair to say that a properly motivated private owner in the long term will be a better source of the larger funds for the very large projects that might come down the road in the long term. But those projects are not things that we're considering today, this year or next year.
And that, just to be clear, is because you simply don't have the level of profit at the moment means you can't invest and you haven't received any money from the government since 2019. So those big projects you're not able to invest in.
No, not quite. It's like unwinding a spiral. We've unwound the losses to a small profit. Now we've got to turn a small profit into a bigger profit. And you use iteratively more investment to unwind that spiral. But you've got to have the confidence that you're already profitable and you're growing to be able to do that. Otherwise, it would be an irresponsible decision to throw some large amount of money out there. So you've got to do it bit by bit, step by step. And so the big investments are not today, tomorrow or next year. They're in 5 years' time and 10 years' time, by which time I would expect that we've had a credible bid from somewhere and we've accepted it and we've recommended it and the deal's been done.
So that investment that's required is conditional on the sale of the airport?
The long-term investment, I'm sure, because I doubt that our owners have got the appetite for putting big money into Prestwick, but we don't need it right now. We've got a cash balance that we're sustaining our business on a day-to-day basis. That cash balance can be used for short to medium term strategic projects, which give value to get a better return for the taxpayer.
Okay. Lord Fraser.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, gentlemen. I just got a couple of fairly short questions just to follow up on Colin Smith's line of questioning about potential sales. Can you just explain to us how the credibility of bids is actually determined? Is that done by you, or is it done by the Scottish Government?
It's done by us, and the board here at Prestwick considers each bid on its own merits. So typically it will start with something as simple as a questionnaire to be filled in by the potential bidder. The bids will come in when they do come in, usually by letter, and it's all very nice to read. But we need more detail. Inevitably, we need more detail. So typically we want to know, what's your plan for the airport? In broad terms, what's your plan for the airport? What's your backing in terms of finances? What's your experience to deliver said plan? And there are a few questions around that to start with. And depending on the answers we get, we'll get into more detail. But sometimes we get bids where there are really no credible plans and no credible money, and it's almost pie in the sky. There are others where there are credible plans, but no money, and so on. So we start to kind of drill into these things and filter them. And if we can tick enough boxes, we then say, look, this is worth spending some management time on. Because if it's not worth spending management time on, the board really needs Ian and his team to concentrate on the day job and deliver day-to-day business.
Okay, and at what point then do you advise the Scottish Government that a bid has come in? Is that done routinely, or is it only where you receive a bid that you think is credible and appropriate. And the reason I ask the question is because clearly there's a lot of public money tied up here, so you would expect the Scottish Government to want to be cited on bids that were coming in.
The Scottish Government is cited on every letter that comes in of interest in bidding for the airport. They're also cited on the process that takes place at board level as to whether that is credible or not, and then they're cited further on whether there's a recommendation or not and why.
Okay. And my final question is there any potential conflict of interest here, given that, you know, if the airport is sold, presumably you will not anymore be in the positions that you currently hold?
Well, it's probably me that you're talking to there, because Ian's the chief executive and he could easily do a good job for a new buyer, just as he does for this buyer. So it's about me and the board. And quite honestly, I've got plenty of other things to do with my time, but I enjoy this job. And I think I've brought value to the airport since I've been here, and I'll continue to do so until I'm not required anymore. But when I'm not required, we'll shake hands and I'll leave.
And for me, I'm just so passionate about this airport. It's got so many things it can do and deliver. So yes, if we get the right bidder, and it needs to be sustainable. It can't just be anyone. These are the airport fans, the aviation fans that can bring finance, can bring all those things back to the right player that we want in here to ensure the long-term success of the airport.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
And that brings us very neatly to the end of this evidence session. So I'll thank Ian Forgey and Forsyth Black for joining us today. Thank you.
Thank you.
And I'll briefly suspend now to allow for a changeover of witnesses. Okay, I'd now like to welcome Neil Gray, Cabinet Secretary for Wellbeing, Economy, Fair Work and Energy, and Colin Cook, Director for Economic Development of the Scottish Government. I would invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement.
Thank you very much indeed, Convener. Good morning. Good morning, colleagues. Welcome the opportunity to appear again before the committee today. Before I move on, I'd like to remind the committee that there is a non-disclosure agreement in place between Glasgow Prestwick Airport and the parties responsible for a recent expression of interest in purchasing the airport. And as I set out when accepting an invitation to appear at the committee today, these agreements mean I'm unable to share any additional information concerning this expression of interest, but I'll obviously look to discuss the situation as best as I can. In 2013, Scottish ministers intervened to secure the future of Glasgow Prestwick Airport, a vital asset to Scotland's economy, which would have ceased to operate without our intervention. Glasgow Prestwick Airport is at the heart of a growing aerospace cluster in South Ayrshire, delivering high-quality jobs, supporting economic growth across the region, and the airport continues to be vital to our economy, providing global connectivity relied upon by business throughout Scotland. Our intervention at Glasgow Prestwick has secured not only the future of 330 employees directly employed by the airport, but also many more beyond across Ayrshire. Scottish ministers remain committed to supporting our investment in the airport. The board of directors and senior leadership team of Glasgow Prestwick Airport have worked diligently to put the business on a sound footing following a turbulent period in private ownership. The commitment, professionalism and experience of the management team and employees across the business at Glasgow Prestwick not only help it to survive, but now to thrive. This year's accounts, published on the 20th of November, show that the focus on the diversified nature of its operations has created a stronger business model for the airport, allowing it to adapt to the ever-evolving nature of the aviation industry. And I look forward to seeing this positive progress continue. I was pleased to take the opportunity to visit Prestwick last month, where I spent the morning touring the airport facilities, meeting with a number of people who work for the business. And I was particularly impressed by the extensive plans that have been drawn up to improve airside facilities, reduce the airport's carbon impact, and further bolster Prestwick's unique offering in the marketplace. I was also encouraged to hear about the collaborative work that is ongoing with Ayrshire College to address the shortage of skilled employees in the sector. It is clear that the Prestwick leadership team have left no stone unturned in order to ensure that the business is best equipped to meet the challenges of the future. As the committee are aware, the board of Glasgow Prestwick Airport received an inquiry in March of this year expressing an interest in acquiring the airport. The board carefully considered this expression of interest and have confirmed that it would not be appropriate to go further. I wrote to the committee on the 14th of September, setting out that I had accepted the board's recommendation that the expression of interest did not present a compelling business case and did not demonstrate the credibility and aviation and airport experience to deliver a sustainable future for Glasgow Prestwick Airport. However, I must reiterate, our door remains open for expressions of interest and we will carefully consider any credible offer from credible parties. We have been clear since our acquisition of Glasgow Airport that it is our intention to return it to the private sector at the appropriate time and opportunity. That position has not changed, nor has our commitment to securing a long-term future for the business. I've asked my officials to review all options for the future of Glasgow Prestwick Airport, including planning for a return to the private sector, and the best means of achieving this objective when the circumstances are right. As you would expect, Convener, my officials have commissioned expert legal and commercial advice, which will inform the options taken forward for consideration. We wish to secure a sustainable future for the business, which recognises not just the commercial value in the business itself, but the wider contribution it makes to the local and regional economies which it serves. We wish to return the business to the private sector. However, we are not a distressed seller. If the time and circumstances are not right for achieving a sale on the best possible terms for ministers and taxpayers, we are confident that Glasgow Prestwick Airport will continue to flourish under our ownership. And I look forward to discussing said future with the committee with interest this morning.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Let me start with just a very general question. What involvement does the Scottish Government have in setting the strategy for the airport?
So my senior officials, led by Colin Cook, have regular engagement with the airport. We sit on the operations board, and we have a responsibility set out in the management statement of how the strategy for the airport is set out. So we have close involvement. However, day-to-day operational decisions are obviously commercial matters for the management and the board.
So you fully participate in the decisions that are being taken by the board?
We participate in the strategic direction of the airport. Obviously, commercial decisions, day-to-day operations, are commercial decisions for the airport to take.
Yeah, understood. Given that the ultimate aim is to return the airport to the private sector, how does that impact on the strategy, the strategic direction of the airport at this time?
I think you heard pretty clearly from the leadership team in your earlier session that their focus on growing the business, on ensuring that it continues to have an upward profitability spiral, is one that obviously makes it inherently marketable in the private sector and makes it a stronger asset for the Scottish Government, but also to ensure that we receive return to the public purse. So obviously the strategy of continuing to see a good, strong business being commercially viable is one that's conducive to moving it back to the private sector.
But realistically, if you're setting strategy for the short to medium term, let's say, you're always going to have this looming in the background that there's going to be a sale, and therefore the strategy is bound to some extent to be affected by that.
I think, as I said, I think the evidence from this morning would suggest that actually the two go hand in hand, and the work that's been done by the airport to make sure that it's an ongoing going concern and is becoming a strong asset is one that means that the strategy, the long-term strategy, is working for the airport. Clearly, the day-to-day operational decisions that the airport take, again, have proven to be strong, and they continue to operate in a way that is returning a business to becoming a strategic economic asset for this country.
Thank you. Let me turn to Murdo Fraser, followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning,
morning,
Cabinet Secretary. The Scottish Government has set up a strategic commercial assets division to manage its investments in private enterprises like Prestwick Airport. Is this going to make any practical difference to the way that the airport's investment is being managed?
So this was to set up SCAD was a recommendation of Audit Scotland to ensure that we were effectively managing our strategic assets that were under our ownership. And I think it has meant that there is a greater involvement of senior officials in the operations of those businesses, and means that we've got a very close working relationship. As I reiterated to the convener, day-to-day operational decisions are commercial matters, but having a close working relationship on the strategic direction is clearly very important. And I think, I believe, I'll turn to Colin in terms of a more practical day-to-day perspective, I believe that it has been an improvement in terms of the way that we are operating with our strategic assets. But I don't know if, Colin, you would wish to comment further.
I would. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The Strategic Commercial Assets Division is part of my directorate, part of the Economic Development Directorate. It was an initiative championed by the Permanent Secretary as a response to observations and recommendations from Audit Scotland about the management of those assets. And its role is to lead for the, to provide a centre of expertise for the Scottish Government on all throughout the life cycle of asset management. So everything from looking externally to see whether there are potential assets that are in distress, through to the process of acquisition, the process of managing an asset, and ultimately, should this be in the public interest and in line with ministerial objectives, the process of divesting of that asset. I'm confident that we have put together a team that has the expertise and the skills to do all of that. And I'm also confident that we have a network of advisors that we can call upon who we're working with, who have the right professional expertise to add value to that process. So in that sense, I do think that we have made a difference to the way in which our assets are managed. And I think Audit Scotland have commented very positively about the difference that we are making.
Mm-hmm. So what was the gap in knowledge or oversight that was identified that led this to be established?
I think I'm not sure I'd characterise it as a gap so much as a set of recommendations from Audit Scotland that suggested that we should bring the various functions that were across the Scottish Government together and to consolidate them, and by doing that would be able to strengthen our approach. So, for example, the asset that we're talking about today, Prestwick Airport, was 2 years ago would have been managed by a different part of Scottish Government. It would have been managed by Transport Scotland. We've managed to bring them into a central team. So I'm responsible for Ferguson Marine, I'm responsible for Prestwick Airport, and I'm responsible for the Scottish Government's interests in the Lough Arbour aluminium smelter and hydro. So we have brought all three of those together. And it also means we're able to learn lessons from previous projects, such as our involvement with BIFAB. So we bring all that together, we're able to consolidate our learning, develop the skills that are required, because they're very, very similar in the way in which we act as a shareholder, and I think we'll strengthen our approach as going forward.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Can I bring Kevin Stewart in just before Maggie Chapman?
Thank you very much, Convener. Obviously, we've heard a little there about the Strategic Commercial Assets Division, which I think we would all welcome that being in existence. And the Cabinet Secretary has rightly pointed out that this is looking at strategy rather than day-to-day operations. But in terms of some of the questioning today around about strategy and not just day-to-day operations, some of the answers were a little bit vague, shall we say. So I asked a question around about military operations, the reliance and the income from military operations. And I asked, obviously, around about the fact that these things can change quite rapidly. What is the strategy in ensuring that revenue stream continues? Pretty vague. In terms of the ambitions to create a spaceport in the area, pretty vague. The move to sustainable aviation fuel and the opportunity that there is there, pretty vague. So could I ask Cabinet Secretary and Mr Cook as well, if you want to bring him in, what's the level of scrutiny from the Strategic Commercial Assets Division in terms of teasing out the prospects of some of these things happening? What is the level of scrutiny in terms of that strategic planning? Not the day-to-day operations, but the strategic planning.
Well, first of all, with regards to the diversity of income that comes from the site, the airport site, military flights and military income has been a factor for Glasgow Prestwick Airport since the 1930s. It goes back quite a considerable time, and that ongoing diversity is incredibly important to make sure, as I think Mr MacDonald's questioning of the senior management demonstrated, of the interrelationship that there is between the airport itself, the actual physical, the passenger element, and the military element, as well as the wider business operation, which also sees other businesses being located on the site. And so there is, of course, to answer Mr Stewart's question directly, ongoing scrutiny and ongoing involvement of both myself and Colin Cook and his team. We have people sitting observing on the operationals board on a regular basis, and I think that has been an enhancement of, to respond again to Mr Fraser's question, to the creation of SCAD, in allowing us to have that overview of the way that our assets, not just Glasgow Prestwick in this case, but our other assets operate as well, to ensure that we are stretching them, you know, in terms of the what they are seeking to develop through the site. And we've spoken about the opportunities that exist there for the spaceport, as well as the advent of sustainable aviation fuel and the strategic importance that Prestwick Airport plays in the delivery of aviation fuel across the network. You know, we need to make sure that, as we are doing, that they continue to pedal fast to ensure that that continued development happens at pace, and to ensure that the opportunities that they have before them are being realised.
So on the specific point around about sustainable aviation fuel, because, you know, the answer that was given, oh, it might happen in 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, I'm not going to give a date at this moment in time, which to me is very, very vague. I hope that, you know, the Strategic Commercial Assets Division are managing to get a little bit more out of them than that. I think the other thing in that regard that was said was, well, we are master planning, and it may well be, you know, that the master plan will deliver this, but maybe not this. You know, my you know, experience with master planning is you set a course for delivery, and if something doesn't happen, you know, that's a wee bit of a failure, to say the least. So I just want to get your thoughts, Cabinet Secretary, in terms of that level of scrutiny and banishing that vagueness in terms of the government and the divisions dealing with Prestwick Airport.
I'll happily take Colin Cook again on the interrogation of that in more detail. In terms of the master planning, I think in the business space, obviously, we'd be looking for investments to come off and for the delivery point that Mr. Stewart rightly makes to happen. However, with nascent technologies such as the likes of sustainable aviation fuel, with infrastructure still being put in place, so that the first transatlantic flight only just coming on stream recently, clearly some of these investments are going to be risky, are going to be tricky, are not, some may not come off. So I think that was the point that was being made earlier by the senior management, was that there are opportunities for the site. Some will come off, some may not. Obviously, our job in government is to try to support them as best as we possibly can, to see as much of the opportunity that is before them realised, but recognising the fact that in a commercial world, it's not always as straightforward as everything being delivered, but the commercial decision that needs to be applied as well as the practical. I don't know if, Colin, you have anything to add.
Well, I mean, as the Cabinet Secretary says, I mean, we are represented on the OPSCO as an observer, so we get to hear and where appropriate, input into the strategic discussions of the board. Ultimately, it is ministerial approval of the appointment of the chair and non-executives, so we have that influence over the direction of the organisation. I look upon my team as having the role of representing Scottish Government policy to explain the context within which the airport is working, and if there's anything that we would wish to follow up after this meeting on the specific of sustainable fuel, I'll certainly do that. And I also think that we have a role in trying to support the airport to achieve its strategic direction. So a good example which you've quoted would be the spaceport, for example. I think it's right and proper that we set out a context which describes the Scottish Government's interest in developing space as a sector, and that the airport should respond to that. Now, that doesn't mean that you know, the actual strategy, the day-to-day strategy for the airport, of course, remains a matter for them. But we would represent that wider context, and they can make decisions within that context.
One final question, you know, obviously, I think everyone wants to see the sale going ahead, and you want to get rid of every possible controversy in order to ensure that that sale happens. I asked a question around about extraordinary rendition and the allegations that Prestwick has hosted extraordinary rendition flights, which, of course, is a breach of international law, extremely controversial indeed. The folks from Prestwick were at pains to say that it would be the UK government to decide who is allowed to land. They said that planes often land with doors remaining locked. I recognise that the Scottish Government has previously gone to the UK Government and asked for assurances that these flights are not happening in Scotland. Could I ask that Cabinet Secretary the Scottish Government could do so once again? Because I think that while there are allegations about these controversial flights landing at the likes of Prestwick, it may be a little bit more difficult to actually get that sale through because some folk would not want to touch that kind of controversy with a barge pole.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. I'd be happy to do that. I'd be happy to make sure. But my understanding is, as was set out in the earlier evidence session, but I'd be happy to seek further confirmation from UK ministers on that fact.
Thank you.
OK, let me turn to Maggie Chapman, followed by Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks very much, Colin. Good morning, both. Thank you for being with us this morning. Actually, following on from one of the lines of questioning from Kevin Stewart, talking about the sort of medium-term strategic outlook for the airport. Obviously, the Scottish Government considers it to be a strategic infrastructure asset, and the decision taken 10 years ago to save jobs ultimately is noted. But I suppose that there's a question for me in the relationship between government ownership of the airport and its ability to deliver on its strategic priorities, whether that's business diversification, whether it's net zero, any of the elements that they mentioned in the earlier panel, and the shift that would happen with a transfer of ownership or releasing it back to the private sector, where there wouldn't necessarily be the same potential for conditions, for focus on certain elements of those strategic objectives. I'm just wondering, Neil, if you could say a little bit about what your assessment is of the likelihood of Prestwick becoming the kind of airport that you think it should be under government ownership compared to private sector ownership.
So the operations of the airport remain as close to what they would be on a commercial basis. Mm-hmm. So the decisions that they are taking, they are doing so with a view to continuing to see profit derived and continuing to see the airport as a business being marketable in the commercial space. I think that's important to set out. The second element is that whether it's at Glasgow Prestwick, where we have more influence given what Colin Cook has set out, or indeed the work that we do with other airports across Scotland on making sure we're setting out our expectations on how they are operating at their environmental standards. The questions that you posed around to the board, the chief executive and the chair, around wider decarbonisation, but also their impact on the environment. Those are expectations that we have of other airports as well. And regardless of whether they're in the public or the private sector, we would continue to have those discussions. But in terms of what we are doing to try to make sure that the airport is operating as effectively as possible and as sustainably as possible, that's been set out. And we will continue to work with them to ensure that the decisions that they're taking not only ensure that they're minimising the environmental impact that they have, but also that they continue to be a successful business.
OK, I mean, I understand what you say about the expectations you would have of any business, any airport, regardless of ownership structure or model. But I suppose there's a question for me, given what I think that their annual report indicates as a success. You know, it's on track to reach its, in terms of its operations, it's on track to reach a 50% carbon emission reduction by 2030. You know, there's the vague but present, you know, thinking around opportunities around sustainable aviation fuel and other things. Is there, in terms of the airports, not only their carbon emission reduction, but they're shifting to the broader net zero space for Scotland's industry and energy accounting. Is there something that, are there conditions that the Scottish Government can put on it as the owner that couldn't happen in the private sector? And I suppose I was quite surprised actually that given it's been in public ownership for 10 years, there wasn't a social responsibility investment statement, that you know, there wasn't a clear ESG, there isn't a clear ESG statement. And could we as public owners of it be doing better right now, never mind that forward look and hope for you know a different model in the future?
I think that's a fair challenge from Ms. Chapman as to whether or not we could be doing more, and the expectations that we have on not just Glasgow Prestwick but other airports across Scotland and other businesses in terms of their environmental credibility and the support that we need from them in order for us to achieve our net zero objectives. I think they demonstrated and they set out quite clearly the levels of regulation that they're currently under in terms of the wider environmental impact, and they also have very clear objectives in terms of their decarbonisation. So whether that's mandated by us or whether that is actually a commercial decision that has been taken because they recognise, as most businesses do, that the more sustainable businesses are going to be the most successful businesses going forward, I think it is there for colleagues to observe. And I think the decisions that they're taking are the right ones in order to ensure that they're supporting us and meeting our objectives.
Okay, my final question, if I may, is just to, in your opening remarks, you talked about the relationship that the airport has with Ayrshire College and the skills development within that. Can you just say a little bit more about that and how you see that as being central to the broader objectives that we've already been talking about this morning for the airport's future?
I think it's the type of work that is going to be critically important, not just in Ayrshire, but in other regions where you've got a critical employer area, because you know, Glasgow Airport isn't just one employer, there are a number of employers on the site, and a local college and working together to look at answering some of the skills demands that are there and having that strong relationship in taking forward the skills gaps that may exist and ensuring that there is also an aspiration from the young people going through the college system and understanding that they have good careers, good job prospects in their local area. And I think that is really important for people to feel that their home is somewhere that they can continue to live and have successful careers in and be proud of where they live. So I think I'm pleased that relationship is developing. Obviously look to support it, not least given the review that has come through from Mr. Withers in terms of what we need to do to, in reshaping our skills agenda, and refer colleagues to my colleague Graham Day's statement earlier this week on how we're taking that forward. But very pleased to see that interaction and that relationship developing.
Okay, thanks. I'll leave it there.
Thank you. Evelyn Tweed, followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary.
Morning.
Good morning, Mr. Cook. Cabinet Secretary, the Scottish Government have stated that in considering any proposed purchase of the airport, they will consider what represents good value for taxpayers and secures the longer-term future of Prestwick Airport. Can you define for us what good value looks like?
I thank Ms. Tweed for this question, Convener, because I think it sets out one of the key considerations that we've got across our strategic assets, that of cost and value, because the actual cost outlay that has been made and ensuring that there is a financial return for the taxpayer is an important consideration that obviously has a bearing in terms of our overall decision around the overall value. But I've set out, Mr. Cook, and previously the Chair and the Chief Executive excuse me, have set out the wider economic value and the hub for economic activity that the airport site is in supporting economic activity within the Ayrshire Regional Economic Partnership area. And so it's of critical importance that any decision that we take going forward obviously has to maximise financial value, the hard financial value for the taxpayers' investment, but also has to consider the economic impact on the region in terms of jobs, in terms of any new business opportunity that may be coming through. So there are a number of considerations that will be taken, should there be, which I hope there will be, further expressions of interest coming forward in acquiring the airport.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. And when Prestwick Airport is sold, how will the government ensure that it continues to have that positive impact on Ayrshire and its communities?
So there are things that we can do that are contingent upon the sale around long-term activity. And those need to be balanced off against ensuring that we secure a sale. But obviously, it's going to be in a new owner's interests of ensuring that there is a good relationship with the local community, ensuring that they have a good positive economic story to tell in terms of the jobs that they're creating, because that will determine the overall success or profitability of the airport itself, having a strong domestic local supply chain and supply chain networks. All of this will, I suspect, be important considerations for a potential buyer to be considering, and would be areas that we would be interested in ensuring longer term for the airport as well.
Thank you.
Gord MacDonald, followed by Kevin Stewart.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Pat.
Good morning.
I want to continue the conversation I had with the previous panel about accounts and profitability and so on. So your opening statement, Cabinet Secretary, was that you're going to be looking at all options. If we're looking at the best interest of the public purse, are you going to be also looking at public ownership?
Potentially. I wouldn't rule that out, Convener. I think it depends on the expressions of interest that come forward, clearly. The panel this morning set out some of those that have come through down the years. I said in my opening statement, we're not a distressed seller. We're in a position where the airport is an asset. It is profitable and is doing incredibly well in terms of having an impact on the local economy. That said, our strategy, our overall objective is to see it return to the commercial sector, but we will only do so when the time is right for and the deal is right for the public purse and for the local area.
So my concern is that same question that I gave to the previous panel. If you look at the net asset value of the holding company, it's a net liability of £14 million. Mm. However, we've got Prestwick Airport Limited, which already cross-subsidised the airport operation, which is loss-making, and Prestwick Airport Limited has a value of £30 million. So how are you going to attract a buyer when there is no value in the airport and it's operating at a loss?
So obviously, Convener, Mr MacDonald will understand this, that there is a group position that needs to be considered here, that the consideration of the passenger airport it cannot be taken in isolation versus the rest of the group and the income that comes and is derived from that. I take the point, and there is clearly an issue with regards to the outstanding loan to the Scottish Government that will be, of course, of consideration to any potential buyer, and that continues to be on commercial terms. However, I think the overall position of the group, I suspect, although I am not operating within the commercial world, I suspect will make it an attractive proposition, and I hope that we can continue to see the development of the airport in such a way that it becomes even more attractive in the commercial world.
I accept 100% that Prestwick's a fantastic asset. I accept it's strategically important and so on. Where the danger is, in my eyes, of moving it back into private ownership is asset stripping. Hmm. Because you're in a situation where all of the value of the company is in a 900-acre site with 70 leases. Hmm. There is no value in the airport operation itself. Hmm. So if you return it to private ownership, then the focus will not be on the airport, in my mind. The focus will be on this asset of 900 acres in Ayrshire. And we already have CalMac run operating ferries, which are owned by the Scottish Government. We've now got ScotRail, which is owned by the Scottish Government. We've got Lothian Buses here in Edinburgh, which is owned via the councils, but who are funded by the Scottish Government. I'm just trying to understand why the thinking is that we should be moving it into private ownership when there is that danger of asset stripping, and this, you know, it's a strategic asset which is to the good of the country in the long term.
And to be clear, the strategic asset is not just the passenger airport. The strategic asset is the wider site.
Absolutely.
Which I have to be clear upon. But I absolutely accept the point, and Mr. McDonald's analysis, I think, is fair, which is why, going back to Ms. Tweed's question, you know, there are potential stipulations that we can put upon a sale. I'm not saying that that is what we're doing, but to give assurance to him. And we would hope that the work that the board and the management team are doing around ensuring that the operations of the passenger airport become more profitable, come to fruition as well, to ensure that Mr. McDonald's fears are not realised. But this will all be part of the consideration we take forward. The other element that I just wish to point out is, while the airport is publicly owned, we don't own the airlines that go within it. I know Mr. McDonald understands that. So the comparisons that he's making with some of the other elements here are slightly different. This is about ensuring the wider site continues to be a strategic asset, continues to operate in a successful manner. And I'm keen, I know my team of officials are keen, to ensure that the passenger airport continues to improve its position as well.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Brian Whittle, followed by Colin Smith.
Thank you. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Good morning, Mr. Cook. From the outset, I'll say, you know, I've got a big interest in Prestwick Airport all my life, and I think it's a phenomenal asset and has potential, you know, huge potential for the area. So, but you'll know probably from my line of questioning this morning that I'm really concerned about the relationship with wind farm operators, specifically around public inquiry that was recently published. And mm-hmm. I know there's ongoing public inquiries which we can't discuss, but it is around this approach to the way in which they are looking to mitigate issues of building wind farms around, mm-hmm. around the airport, and the requirement upgrade of radar, specifically to the Terma radar. And I think I intimated that I spoke to Nats last week on mm-hmm. this, to look at what the actual requirement is, and also with some of the wind farm operators. And cut to the chase, as was accepted by our previous panel, these mitigation and ongoing payments from wind farms are now being seen as an income stream, and the report says there's no basis for ongoing compensatory payments, and the way in which they are now being calculated by the airport around a megawatt, a per megawatt charge, is not appropriate. And finally, the way in which NDAs are being used to prevent some of this, these arrangements being made public, is against similar agreements between commercial parties and wind farm developers. So, can I ask, how much are you aware of this? How much does this concern you? Because, thankfully, the airport is in profit. But if these public inquiries continue to find in this way, that income, which shouldn't be an income stream because it's supposed to be specifically for mitigation of impact of radar, that would impact the profitability of the airport. How much of that are you aware of that?
So obviously, I have to be careful because I've got two interests here. One is in terms of our responsibility in determining some of the applications that we're talking about, and also the fact that we've got the shareholder ownership of the airport itself. I think suffice to say, I am aware of the situation. I heard the evidence this morning from the airport, and on my visit, I heard clearly from them the feeling that they have of the impact of the wind farms that they have neighbouring to their site. What I would say is that the reporter has gone through a process. The reporter has concluded, the recommendation has been made, which ministers have accepted, and I would expect the airport, obviously, to comply with the decision of the reporter and to ensure that there is an ongoing negotiation with wind farm developers in order to ensure that a fair settlement is reached.
I'm really pleased to hear the Cabinet Secretary take that approach, but it's a bit of a contrast to what I heard earlier on from the airport, to be quite
frank. They've got a commercial interest, obviously, and I respect that, but we've got a regulatory and a planning interest. So, of course, I expect the airport to comply with the recommendation that has been found from the reporter and the direction that has been given by ministers.
Sorry, but they have a commercial interest and they report to the board. Mm-hmm. Of which that is the Scottish Government, the shareholders. So,
well, no, the board is not the shareholders.
Sorry, the board report to the, yes, to the shareholders, correct, which is the Scottish Government. So, yes, the commercial interest is your commercial interest as well.
And obviously, that is a separate consideration when we're deciding upon a planning application. I hope Mr. Whittle will respect
that. The point I'm going to make is, having spoken to some of the wind farm operators, they absolutely accept that it is their responsibility to mitigate any impact, mm-hmm, on the airport. There's an absolute acceptance of that. I think the issue in which I didn't get an answer from, although I asked several times, was around any money that's coming in from a wind farm operator must be demonstrable. And it must be for it must be used for mitigating against any impact on the radar. And I never got an answer to that. And I'm asking you, Cabinet Secretary, that is that your understanding? And you know, what will you do to ensure that money that's being raised from wind farm operators is used for the purpose of mitigating?
Yes, it is my understanding, and I would expect that to be the case. I think it's also important to set out that since these findings, since these public inquiries, we've published the onshore wind sector deal with developers, and they've agreed on a voluntary basis to have earlier negotiation and discussion to ensure that any potential impact, in this case on airports, but in other communities and other situations, happens. It's also to ensure that there's earlier communication with communities around community development and a community benefit, to ensure that there is a strategic and a more creative use of community benefit finance, to ensure that communities can actually see demonstrable benefit. But in this case, it's about ensuring that where there is a potential development, that developers are having earlier conversations to ensure that there is a more collaborative approach taken so that some of these issues can be resolved before there is a need for a public inquiry to be taken, because I think in terms of the delays that poses to developers, but also to the uncertainty it causes communities and businesses, I think it's in everyone's interest that we come to set these decisions in a quicker fashion.
But you would accept, though, that mitigation for
mm-hmm. I said that it
should not be seen as an income stream.
It is an income stream, but it's for what purpose? Of course it is an income stream, but it's to what purpose? And in this case, I think Mr. Whittle is right, the purpose has to be to ensure that it is funding the mitigations that are required because of the developments that are being set out.
Thank you.
Thank you. Colin Smith, followed by Murdo Fraser.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Mr. Gray, you said earlier that the government's involvement in Prestwick has allowed it to not just survive but thrive. So I suppose 10 years on since the government bought the airport, why hasn't there been a bid for the airport that in the eyes of the government was credible? I mean, what are the blockages to the sale at the moment?
Well, that point was contradicted by the panel this morning, that there was a credible bid came forward pre-COVID, but obviously given the situation that the impact that COVID had, that fell through. Clearly, I want to see a situation where we are, as I've set out in response to other questions, I want to see the airport return to the commercial sector. We're not going to do that on any terms. We want those terms to be clear, that they're going to provide a clear future pathway for the airport, that they demonstrate that they've got the finance and the experience in order to be able to make it a success, and that they're going to continue to show and demonstrate wider economic development within the area. We're not going to sell on any terms. We want to ensure that those are realised, and we see the maximum possible return for the public purse, as well as the maximum possible value for the Scottish economy. So I think, you know, I would continue to encourage any potential expressions of interest to come forward, and we will consider those in the appropriate ways.
Just to clarify that point that was raised by Gordon MacDonald, in terms of the criteria you've set for a sale around repayment of loans, around jobs, in terms of those passenger services, is that a criteria that they have to be maintained? Notwithstanding that the airlines are separate from the airport, but you would not agree to a sale that included removing passenger flights from the airport?
No, we would. I think it would be quite clear that we'd be expecting an ongoing commitment to the airport and ensuring that there is a continued activity there.
So it's in terms of the implication, I suppose, of the limbo position we find ourselves in the moment, where on the one hand you want to return the airport to the private sector, but on the other hand the private sector at the moment don't seem to want that. What are the implications of that limbo that we're in at the moment?
I think we need to consider the economic environment that we're currently operating within, where I think it's fair to say that airports and airlines have been through more than a little turbulence, to pardon the pun, with the particularly the COVID pandemic, but other economic shocks that have hit over recent years. And so I'm hopeful that we'll see continued interest in the airport, but I'm not concerned, not least because the airport is in a good financial situation, and its position continues to improve, so we're not a distressed seller, and we will look at any expressions of interest based upon the strength that the current asset is holding.
In terms of the implications, though, you say it's in a good financial position and it's certainly making a profit, but one of the implications you didn't mention is the fact that the £43.4 million of loans to Prestwick from the government are now currently valued at just £11.6 million, so that's potentially a loss to the taxpayer of several million pounds. I mean, when do you anticipate those loans or part of those loans being paid back, or is it just purely on the basis of when there's a sale, it's part of the criteria?
The position that has been set out is subject to change in terms of the £11 million valuation of the loan. There's a current revaluation underway of the airport, which obviously I can't preempt, but I would expect to see a more, you know, if it does see a more favourable financial position, then the value of the loan on the government's books therefore changes as well in terms of the expectation of realising a return. But we want to see a return of the loan as quickly as possible. That is obviously an expectation and has been set out earlier on in terms of the expectation of the current management and the board in terms of how that loan is operating.
So you're continuing to defer that interest. When do you anticipate, given that the company's been a profit?
As soon as we possibly can.
I suppose another implication of this limbo position, and Audit Scotland have said millions more is needed to sustain the current model at Prestwick, but obviously the government haven't put investment in there since 2019. It clearly, in terms of securing the long-term future of the airport, needs investment. Where is that investment going to come from if it's not going to come from the government?
The panel earlier this morning contradicted the point that Mr Smith is making, because they said that the finance that they currently have available is sufficient for the work that they're seeking to undertake. There is nothing to stop them, if is required, coming to us with a bid for finance if that is what they're seeking, or indeed going to the market to seek that if it is required.
I'm sure you accept that a company at the moment that are effectively in limbo, they are not the long-term I suppose, owners of the company, the government want to sell it. It's up for sale at the moment. In terms of long-term investment that could significantly change a lot in the airport, the current management team are not in a position to do that. You're looking to sell the airport to a new owner, and at the moment, the current management team are running on the basis of we're up for sale. So long-term decisions are not going to be made by a company in terms of significant investment.
I don't disagree with Mr. Smith's question there. However, again, the evidence from the panel this morning suggested that that is not an issue that they are facing. That is not something that they are concerned about. And we continue to have discussions with them about the work that they are looking to do, the opportunities that they're looking to realise, and continue to support them in any which way possible that we can to ensure that those opportunities are realised.
Just come back to the point again. What is that long-term blockage? You don't have a queue of people at the door at the moment wanting to buy the airport. What is that? What is the blockage to an airport that is? You've said very positive things about the company's making a profit. So why is there not a queue at your door to buy that airport? What is the blockage? Is it the criteria? What is the reasons why you haven't accepted any of the bids?
We continue to invite people to come forward with expressions of interest. If the market is not there, the market is not there. I think the commercial position of the airport is strong, and there has previously been a note of interest that came earlier this year that wasn't followed through for the reasons that have been set out. There was before COVID a very strong case, a very strong expression of interest, that were it not for the advent of COVID, it probably would have seen the business return to the private sector. So that demonstrates that in my mind, I do not have a particular concern, as Mr. Smith seems to, around the long-term future of the airport, and will continue to take any expressions of interest coming forward seriously and ensure that while we're able to maximise the return, both from an economic and a financial perspective, and the value for the local area, we will obviously still be pragmatic in seeking to achieve as much as possible without hindering a process going forward that can see it return to the private sector.
I certainly don't have a major concern. I have a real hope, given it's in my South of Scotland region. But at what point, how far down the line before you start to consider the point that was made earlier about actually maybe the public ownership model is the best way forward?
Well, that's the status quo, and so we don't need to shift from that. And as I say, we're not a distressed seller. It is in a good position. It has good plans to continue to grow. So I'm not concerned at the position that we have with regards to Glasgow Prestwick Airport.
Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Convener. Thanks again, Cabinet Secretary. Just a couple of questions to follow up Colin Smith's line of questioning around a potential sale. We were discussing with the previous panel their role as the management in terms of assessing bids. What is the relationship then between them and the Strategic Commercial Assets Division in the government in terms of who assesses a bid?
So they will take first consideration and will contact us if there has been an expression of interest, and will give us detail as to what's come forward. Obviously, that is predicated on that expression of interest going to them first. If they come to the government, then we would look to assess some of that as well. But the first port of call is through the board and assessment process that comes through there.
Right. But I mean, ultimately, it's a Scottish Government decision.
Yes.
To accept any bid?
Yes.
Okay. So we've got loans outstanding to the taxpayer of 43.4 million. Are there circumstances in which you would accept a bid less than that?
So this is where the consideration on the hard financial position and the wider value would come into play, and I hope Mr. Fraser would understand that there may need to be pragmatism in that sense, depending on what the bid looked like and depended on the wider factors that they were taking, such as Mr. Smith's point around wider investment that they may seek to make within Glasgow Prestwick Airport. But that would be subject to discussions on a case-by-case basis.
Okay.
But obviously, just underline, we'll be looking to realise maximum return that we can to the public purse, clearly.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions from members? No? In that case, thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary and Mr. Cook. And I suspend the meeting and we'll move into private session.
Thank you. Thank you, colleagues.